best boxing podcast in the world.
Are you ready? No! I said, are you ready?
Instructions from the dressing room. Do you have any questions?
I got a question. You got any excuses tonight, Roy?
Let's not ask questions like that. Let's touch gloves and go to work.
Tonight, Roy.
Let's go to work.
I wish I was 50 years younger and I'd kick your ass.
Come on, dude, we can do that.
You don't know shit about boxing.
What's going on, everybody? Another episode of Cheesy's Box Show. Angelo here, my boy JP. JP, what's up, man?
Let's talk about a lot of nothing.
No, we had fights. Nothing this week. First things first, follow us on Twitter, Cheap Seats Box, iTunes, and Stitcher. Rate, review, subscribe. Help us out, people. Stay up them rankings. You guys have been a little lazy. I guess it's summertime, man. I know. I get it.
Barbecue season.
I get it. Email the show, cheapseatsbox@yahoo.com. Questions, comments, whatever floats your boat, I guess. Welcome to all the listeners. Let me try to go through this. iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, TuneIn, SoundCloud, Podomatic, Windows Phone, YouTube, and
Zoom.
All right, then that was a lot.
Wait,
did I forget one?
Walkman.
Yeah. A Sony Walkman, Sony Discman,
yeah,
with the radio.
Telegraph.
Old MP3 players.
It was a 45 records.
Okay. Basically, what we're saying is we're everywhere.
Yeah.
We're everywhere. This past weekend, past or past, whichever way you want to say it, heard it both ways. the big fight on CBS, Showtime Championship Boxing on CBS, brought to you by the PBC and I'm sure somebody else, and DeBella Entertainment and all the other good stuff. That telecast was kind of like movies. You know the beginning of movies now?
Oh.
It's always a such and such film in association with this film, in association with this film, brought to you by this particular studio.
Yeah.
It's pretty much what it was like. Keith Thurman, Shawn Porter, give us a really good fight. And I think actually it exceeded expectations. What people thought, they thought it was going to be a good fight. I don't know if they thought it was going to be this good of a fight. I wouldn't say it's fight of the year, but I would say it's definitely one of the best fights of the year. You know what I mean? There's two of them that come to mind right away that are better. But that doesn't take away from the greatness of the fight, which on Twitter is exactly what happened. The hateration started right away. Well, this isn't Salido and Vargas. Okay, great. That's fine. It was a good fight. It was a really good fight. And when we're starved for really good fights, it feels even better than it actually was. Who gives a shit? Let people enjoy it. At least boxing was in good light. For once, on a Saturday night. Keith Thurman gets a unanimous decision. 3 scorecards, all the same, 115-113. JP, how'd you see it and how'd you score it?
115-113.
For Thurman?
For Thurman, motherfucker. I picked Porter and I lost.
This is going to be great, though. You'll love what I got to say. Just so you know, me and JP actually have not talked at all. Not 1 minute about anything that happened this weekend.
I'm watching a fight. I think... Put it like this. I had it tied pretty much till the 8th round. And I think between the championship rounds, I gave Thurman 2 of those. That's how he won. Because pretty much the shit was tied to me. Great fight. I got to agree with you. Third best fight of the year, in my opinion, too. But if you don't like that they had a great fight, you out of your fucking mind. Like, what? You don't like exciting boxing, brawling, and blah, 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 headbutting. They was getting dirty with each other. Nobody complained about it. To me, that was one of the best performances of the year. Not the best, But like I said, the number three best. But that shit was entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Thurman, I get it because he lulled. Like, when he started backing off and using the lateral movement, people was like, say, man, nah, don't run. You bullshit. But he really needed, that was how he had to get the distance. Because when Porter's in your face, he in your face, man. Shit, what you want him to do? Just stand against the ropes and get wailed on? He got to do something.
I think they do want that.
Yeah, that doesn't, that works for Porter. It doesn't work for his opponent. But I'm going to say it one good time. I can't wait to see the second fight because they should have another one. And to me, just outright, this is how the competition should be on a regular basis. And this is how people who say they quote unquote friends, they just set a precedent for the PBC, because since, I don't think it's been a fight this good since Marez Santa Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that, you know, Quillen and Jacobs didn't last too long, so but it was good while it lasted. But who was, and there was another fight on ESPN they had. I forget which one that was, but they set a precedent for getting the politics out, because they fought each other, they were friends, they went after each other's heads. What else could you ask for? Now everybody else is going to make you have to step up, not your game in the ring, but your game with opponents before you get in the ring. So I liked it. I loved it. Congratulations to both fighters.
Well, and here's how, this is why I told you that you're going to like where I come from, because I picked Thurman to win. Even on Twitter, I told somebody he'll win 116, 112 on his bike, because that's how he needs to win that fight. I also said he needs to control the clinch, which he didn't. He actually did not. He got pushed around a lot in this fight. I had the fight scored 116, 112 for Porter.
Oh!
And I picked Thurman. Now, the reason why was I thought he controlled a lot of how the fight went. He was pretty much, besides, like you said, those later rounds, like after like 7, where Thurman kind of started controlling the type of fight it was. I thought up until that point, Porter was dictating exactly how that fight was going. I thought he landed just as many clean punches as Keith Thurman did. I thought the fight was actually really close. It's one of those things, like, you score the fight, and then when you go back, you're like, huh, 116, 112, which seems like he won comfortably, but I don't think he won comfortably, because I'm good with the draw. Hell, I'm even good if you have it, Thurman, you know, by 1 point. It's only three rounds difference, and in a fight like this, there was 4, 5, 6 close rounds. Yeah. So it just depended on how you saw it and what you like. And for me, you know, I think that quote-unquote scoring, especially on Twitter and social media and message boards, has been kind of overtaken by those who think that something has to be aesthetically pleasing to be clean. You know, clean punches are only the ones that are thrown by slick boxers who use straight punches. And, you know, it's that Mayweather thing. Well, yeah, but his punch was so clean, you know. Say like the first time when he fought Maidana, right? Well, he hit the cleaner punches. Well, Maidana landed a lot of clean punches. They were just ugly as shit. Ugly doesn't mean it's not clean. And you know he was landing clean punches on Thurman, because Thurman felt them. When he hit him in the body, he'd back up. When he hit him in the head, he'd reset. There was a lot of times when they were up tight and Porter was actually hitting him with uppercuts on the inside, and you'd see his head snap a little bit. Those are clean shots. I know they're not as pretty as sitting from the outside and Thurman hitting with a nice straight right or a 1-2. Yeah, they're not as pretty, but they're still the same to me. I don't I don't differentiate between an ugly clean punch and a pretty clean punch. They're just clean punches to me. And I think a lot of it's been hijacked by those who think it has to be pretty from a distance. I'm controlling things, and the head snaps back a little bit more. And I guess, I think, and if you look at the punch stats, which aren't, you know, look, they're not, you know, everybody knows they're not the be-all, end-all. Porter landed, what was it, one more, two more punches. Mm-hmm. And he actually landed more jabs. Now, would you have thought he would out-jab him? So, yeah, it's not ugly, but look, he actually did, he hit him more punches and more jabs. So, I mean, it's like, now, that, like I said, I have no problem. Either if you scored it, Thurman, I ain't got no problem. Scored it, Porter, no problem. Draw, I don't give a shit. Because it was that close of a fight. Like I said, the fight did dictate. My score isn't what I saw from afar. Like, 116, 8-4. And trust me, there was two or three of those rounds. I was like, eh. Okay, I'll lean this way. But, you know, two of them rounds, I go, okay, I go the other way. It's a draw. It's not that big a deal. Especially in this kind of fight. But, it was. It kind of reminded me of the Garcia. The last one he had, Robert Guerrero, where I thought Garcia won that fight, like just standing from a distance. But then when I look at my score, I got 6 rounds to 6. You know, they're not. You know, some guy can win 8 rounds and just squeak by, and the other guy can dominate those 4 rounds. You're gonna look from a distance and be like, the other guy won. But it was a good fight, and it exceeded expectations. I wish Thurman would have actually controlled the clinch more, you know. But Porter showed to be strong.
Got an idea.
Yes, sir.
We should have a black, Mexican, Puerto Rican, Cuban, European, Asian coalition for scores. Because everybody
sees it a little bit different.
Yes. And we just cut it down, average it out down the middle, and we done.
Yeah. The majority wins this.
Yeah.
Because everybody does see things differently. If you like slick boxers, yeah, you like that outside, that distance where you catch them coming in on a counter. It just, you like those things. You like check hooks. And
exactly.
It just is what it is. And remember, I picked Thurman. So yeah. You know, I wasn't going in like, I'm going to try to give Porter everything I can, because I picked him. That wasn't how it went. There was a couple.
I was trying to give it to Porter. I was trying.
See, but you like a different style.
Yeah.
And that's what goes into judging. That's how you can get these all-off scores. The one thing I'll say is Paulie was cracking me up. He was so trying to discount his loss to Porter. You know, Porter, he can push around guys who ain't natural welterweights. He just can't seem to do that against natural welterweights. And then about 3 rounds later, he's just pushing Thurman around everywhere. Well, I'm a little surprised that he could do this. Like, it's okay, Paulie, you got your ass whipped. It's okay. Just call the fight as you see it.
Porter is a... Okay, the fights that Porter lost... The fighters that he lost to, for one, and the fights that he lost, for two, you kind of look at him like, you just a part, this shit happens. Mm-hmm. But is anybody going to say, oh, when they look at Shawn Porter, oh, you know, he ain't nowhere near washed up.
No.
He ain't nowhere near beat. He ain't nowhere near... over the hill. He not diminishing. None of that shit. He just...
You know what's funny, though? Like, you know, I kind of read the message board. A little bit. You read Twitter a little bit. You hear people talk about it on different shows. And a lot of people, no, I had Thurman. Honestly, it's starting to feel like there's only a couple of people actually doing shows that actually thought Porter won, and everybody at the Barclays Center. That was it.
Yeah, that's true, because they started booing the shit out of it. I was like, you know what? Maybe y'all were up close and personal. Because I'm not, yeah, Porter did control his, it was his style of fight, mm-hmm. most of the fight. I think the reason I gave Thurman the stuff I gave him is because I didn't expect him to fight back in the way he did. Mm-hmm. You know? That was surprising. The fighting back on the ropes. But most of the times when he was on the ropes, his ass was lunch. But when he'll fight back to get out, how can I say this? I kind of had to score it like this. If he could work his way back in the middle of the ring for more than a minute and a half, he won the fight. If his ass was in the, against the ropes or by the ropes or corner more than a minute and a half, he lost that round. You know, so as the fight wore on, he learned to get your ass off these ropes. But, man, if Porter would have won that fight, I couldn't have said anything. You know, it's just, I think really one of the main factors of that fight was you didn't see Thurman necessarily hurt as bad as you saw Porter that night. Because the strongest shot probably was when Thurman hit Porter and he's like, I'm holding on, ref. I fuck your rules. But truth be told, I just got to say this. Porter, you got a hell of a chin. I mean, you got a hell of a chin.
He does have a chin. I would say that Thurman was hurt the worst that night. And I would say Porter was hurt more times. Because he did, Porter did hold on once where it looked like he was shook pretty good. But that one body shot that he hit Thurman with, Thurman damn near turned his back like to run away, like, I gotta go over here for a second. You know? He damn near turned his back like, oh, god damn. It was like Luis Clauser all over again. that's what, like, to see what happens next because, man, the PBC just doesn't know how to capitalize on shit, man. You have a good night of boxing, and then, you know, it's like the Mares,
Santa Cruz,
they didn't capitalize on it. Yeah, Santa Cruz is going to fight Frampton coming up, but, I mean, how long has it been? That's been a while now, has it not?
Feels like it.
Feels like it's been forever.
Feels like it.
And so you just hope that they do something to capitalize on it, to keep his name in the mix. He better be fighting hopefully by October, man. Don't wait till December. It's funny because I was watching this last night, the FS1 card. It was Edner Cherry and Rhodes. I don't know who the hell that guy is, but they said this comment, and I put it on Twitter. I said, man, I hear this a lot at the beginning of a lot of PBC fights.
Wait a minute, but Cherry was wild. I just gotta say
it was a terrible shit. It was a terrible fight. It was a terrible fight. But this saying has been, it's said a lot on PBC cards. And just listen to the start of a fight. He's coming off the longest layoff of his career. You hear that all the fucking time. And you gotta stop hearing that. You heard it on Saturday. Both of those fighters coming off the longest layoffs of their career. The guy before that, it was the longest layoff. I think when Santa Cruz fought Mares, I think Mares was coming off the longest layoff of his career. It's always the longest layoff of their career. Always. When Wilder fights this next fight, it's gonna be the longest layoff of his career. It's always that.
You know, you ain't lying. What's weird is, at some point, just like, you know, we're talking about the Tuesday cards, I'm happy that they're having them. I really am, because you're going to start, you know, if you pay attention to them, sometimes they got great young talent. And sometimes you're like, everybody needs opportunity. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So some of these guys got to move up to those weekend fights. Because if these fighters keep having these layoffs, I think Al Heyman's, in this particular fight, I don't say it's Al Heyman's fault because I've been saying this dude's a fuck up. But some of these layoffs going to make some of Al Heyman's fighter get into a Adonis Stevenson zone where you can even be a champion and be irrelevant because you just out of the mix so long. So at some point, you got to make something happen. You know, I hear the rumors, like, you know, add to Danny. You know, you might fight Danny next, then Danny might fight Pacquiao, and Danny Broder might fight Broner.
Broner might fight Pacquiao.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, rumors are, we're not girls. Like, rumors don't make us go, ooh, we're giddy. motherfucker, make the shit happen or shut up. You know what I'm saying? Exactly. If you're going to put them up, I get put the names out there to see who gravitates to what first or which one the fans want to see, but actively make it happen. I mean, you know what? Let's go back. Even though, you know, we understand it was a bit fixed a little bit, but if y'all have an issue, do what Floyd did when he, with you choose, Madonna Khan. You know what I'm saying? You get the fans to get a little PBC app and look, who you want to see him them fight next? Them, and them. Your fans click in, this is what we want to see. So then you got a built-in fan base because this is what they want. The majority of people will watch this, you know?
The undercard, Jarrett Hurd, what'd you think, man?
He was cool.
He's nice. Cool. People are really high on him.
It was cool.
Yeah, I still want to see more.
Yeah.
Was it Oscar Molina? He stopped in the 10th or whatever. Dominated the fight. 154 is a... Right now, it's a bust off. 154 is tough. But that's just another name you're going to throw in the mix of guys that start to step up. I liked him. I mean, he's got a little bit of everything. He doesn't have he doesn't have a huge punch. I think that's the one thing he's missing.
But he got a lot of
he's got power.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, but he doesn't... He has respectable power, you know, that...
Yeah.
He keep you honest.
Lamont Peterson-esque.
Yeah. He can get knockouts, but he's really going to beat you with clean punches and activity.
Yeah.
I thought he was pretty nice. People have been talking about him. My first sustained time watching him. But I liked him. I'm not as high and sold on him yet as others are, because I can name, you can just think, you can run through your head about 10 of them right now at 154. So I'm not sure if he's there where I think he's beating those guys yet. When I start thinking he's beating those guys, that's when you start to feel that, you know.
My bad, I'm sorry about
that. No, you're good.
And I don't mean to sound, be a dick about this, but Verdejo has me skeptical of giving fighters, because you could, like, going back to somebody like Jojo Diaz, I saw greatness the minute I saw him. Like, yeah, this dude's gonna be phenomenal. But these other fighters, like, they good. Mm-hmm. You know, when I saw Tevin Farmer, when I saw his, I said, this dude's he gonna be some serious, he gonna give people some serious damn problems. Mm-hmm. And I still expect that to happen. But these other fighters, I like them, but I don't like them, because I'm like, you know, I don't know, just like you said about the layoffs, when is the next time I'm going to see you? Because remember, that was with, what was that, Monroe? Willie Monroe? Mm-hmm. When he beat Harrison, and then he just...
No, Nelson, Willie Nelson.
Willie Nelson, yeah, I'm sorry. You know, he beat Harrison, and then he just...
He fought like a month before he got beat by... Andrade, and before that fight, coming off the longest layoff of his career, it's constant. That's why PBC, because since they've kind of separated themselves from everybody else, even though they integrate a little bit, you kind of take it as an individual event. You know what I mean? Because you don't know if it's leading to this or anything else. It may just sit on its own. So, you know, like, say, like, you could kind of see it with Crawford and Postal, right? Mm-hmm. You could kind of see where they were going with it. So you're excited, like, how's that matchup going to go? You know, because, you know, Postal impressed with Matisse, and Crawford's been impressing. So you kind of get that, I think this is where it's going to lead to, and then hence it does. Even Jesse Vargas, people got excited. Damn, you know, the thing with Bradley, then he goes and just dominates Ali. And like, where's it going to lead to? And where's it lead to? It's leading to a Brook unification. So a lot of times, a lot of these things lead to other places, unless you're Canelo. I gotta give you your time now on that too. But it's just hard to get excited, and you just have to take it for what it is at that time, and that's all I can do right with those PBC fighters. Even a guy like Robert Easter, I got so excited seeing what he did to Mendez last fight. I ain't heard nothing about his next fight.
And I'm a
well, oh no, he's getting he what? Just got their order for the vacant title. That's what it was. That's
right. I'm going to back up off of this and not just because it's not just the PBC. And as you're saying, I'm thinking about it. I'm like, you know what? Boxing, promotion, and politics, and quote unquote business, has really been killing fighters' momentum. Mm-hmm. You know, I can think of fighters just in general. Since Imam lost, when's the last time you seen him?
I think that was his last fight.
And is he on the PBC? I don't think so. I think he was Don King.
Don King. Well, that kind of explains it.
But but the same thing goes for what's his name? Damn it! I just had it on the tip of my tongue. Anyway, screw that. But it's a top rank fighter.
Okay.
He does good, disappears. You know what I'm saying? Because if it ain't Manny, everybody is on the back burner. You get what I'm saying? That's when you're talking about Postal and Crawford. The thing I was thinking about, okay, so even if Postal or Crawford wins, they're both going to be on ice unless they have a rematch the way that they're working right now. So I'm like, okay, so what's next? You know, then you got, you know, Golden Boy. Golden Boy acts like they're operating with just one fighter. And then you got, I can't say that necessarily about Triple G, but that's how fucked up boxing is right now. When Triple G is trying to keep momentum, and he's getting the short end of the stick, because who you fighting? Well, I mean, even the fighters that we want to see ain't fighting nobody. And that's what I was thinking about. Nicholas Walters. Like, damn. Okay. Nicholas Walters was then just on ice. Same thing with Danny Garcia. He's been doing good, but it's comparison to hypothetically speaking where he probably could have been at this particular point is different. So is it I think the fighters have a lot to do with, just like Wilder. Wilder had constant momentum before he got the title. Now, you know, but I can't blame this Povetkin situation on Wilder.
This one I don't.
Yeah. So, the Arguello situation is like, dude,
There's better things out there than that.
Yeah. So, you know, this is the type of stuff we like, man, as fans, we're just watching, like, you know, it ain't just the PBC, but it's boxing as an entity where we like it, but you're absolutely right. We could say this Porter Thurman fight could probably happen again, just because of the fanfare. You get what I'm saying? But guess what? What else can happen, though? You know, that's the issue. What else can happen? Because would it be on that undercard? We don't know. It got people in 54 that could fight. Mm-hmm. But we don't know if they ever will. You know? So, you got... Some people going to have to move to England.
Speaking of England, let's go there.
Dun, dun, dun.
Great segue, by the way. Quick hits on... All right. Chris Eubank Jr. wins against Tom Duran. No shock there. Calls out Triple G. Supposedly... Eddie Hearn and Loeffler are in negotiations. As much or as little as I think of Eubank Jr., if he does sign to fight Triple G, I give him all the credit in the world, because you call him out and you back it up by fighting. That's all you can ask.
And in this particular situation, I mean, where's Triple G going to go anyways? You know? I mean, between him and I think in that division... Danny Jacobs was talking about fighting Billy Joe. So, you know, if that happens, somebody's going to be ass out. So, we already know who that's going to be, but that's a whole other story. But I love it, you know. Do I think he's ready? He's going to have to prove that shit to me because, you know, I just, you know, yeah, I believe when I see it. But the fact that you got the heart to do it, shit, my hat's off to you. And if you got the heart to do it, that means you believe in yourself enough to think you can pull it off. So I can't be the one to knock you.
No.
You know? So if you prove me wrong, shit. Hey,
Oh, I don't care if you get knocked down too. If you got enough balls to call him out and fight him,
you're all right with me.
You're above 90% of everybody else in and around that division. George Groves dominates Martin Murray, and I guess and this is kind of what I thought it was going to be. I thought Groves was going to beat him. I thought he was going to fade. He didn't fade. And you know, it's funny because people were like talking about on Twitter about it. Like, I was surprised Martin Murray. Give Martin Murray credit for finishing the fight, not quitting. Like, that motherfucker couldn't quit after he called out Groves for being a quitter. That was never an option. Groves beat. He beat a quality opponent, a guy who even at 168, you know, lost two was it a draw and a loss? Yeah. Controversial decisions against Abraham and Sturm that people thought he won. So I mean, give Groves credit. I think it's the best he's looked since the first Frotch fight before he got knocked out. Hopefully, he can rejuvenate himself because he's a fun fighter because he's flawed. He can have some really good fights if he's willing to, you know, to go for it.
Just a question of who.
Exactly.
Who? Man, you know what? 68? Nah, I was about to say Junior, but...
I mean, he lost his fight to Jack. Him and DeGale, you know? Run that back from 5 years ago. You know DeGale still wants the revenge.
Yeah.
DeGale can go, I got the title, and they say, yeah, that's fine, but he still got that one against you.
But isn't him and Jack's fight already on?
Supposed to be. That's what I'm saying, though. Even still, like,
yeah.
And I favored DeGale to win that fight. Still, you know DeGale wants to get a little bit of revenge on that.
Yeah.
You can say whatever you want. The fighter always remembers that shit. Why do you think Lomachenko wants that fight with Salido so bad?
Everybody wants to get revenge. You know, even Gary Russell wants revenge on Lomachenko. Like, I want that shit back.
Do you really?
Hey, he wants it.
And then Anthony Joshua stops Dominic Brazil in 7. The fight was never in doubt. It lasted longer than I thought. I said 2 rounds. It lasted 7. I'll give Brazil credit for that. Joshua was workmanlike, carried his power, didn't seem to get tired. Joshua's just getting better.
You remember watching Martin?
Hmm?
When he fought Tommy Hearns.
Now, hold on. See, because of how he said that, you could have thought of that in two ways. When he fought Charles Martin, he's actually talking about when Martin Lawrence fought Tommy Hearns on the show Martin.
Yeah. That's just all I saw. Even I saw Brazil's face at the fight. I don't want to fight no more. I don't want to fight no more. You got your ass whooped. You know what? I want to say you had hope for going there, but you got your ass whooped.
What do you break down? There's nothing. I mean, there's just takeaways. You know what I mean? Ain't no breakdown. Just takeaway. You take away the fact that I think that
he got a strong face.
No. The hell with Brazil. Joshua is workmanlike. He doesn't get. He's not getting gassed. He's carrying his power through. You know, and this is the longest his fights last, just like the fight with Dillian White. He's carrying the power all the way through, and that's a scary proposition for people.
You know what I like about him at this point? That part of it, and more so the fact that you notice he gets amped up when he knows when he can smell blood in the water. But he doesn't he doesn't punch himself out. I love that, because that means he's got more smarts than people give him credit for. And just to be a young knockout artist, I get that, but he's not gonna kill himself to get to you, because you're like, you know, I'm just keep pounding your ass, and eventually you're gonna come on over.
And if you think about it, that's something that Deontay Wilder still hasn't figured out yet. He gets his opponents hurt, he goes for balls out, man. And that eventually could backfire on you. Not saying it will, but it could.
That's the thing about power.
His let's see if he fights Joseph Parker next. Parker is the mandatory. Says he wants it. Two young fighters. At this point, I favor Joshua big. Mm-hmm. Still, I mean, Parker's nice, but I haven't been wild, and I guess he wasn't overly impressive against Carlos Takam. But again, Carlos Takam is much better than any fighter Anthony Joshua's faced. It's a little, you know.
How about I lay out the proposition? So why don't we just have a card in the UK? You know, Joshua versus Wilder, because he called Wilder out too. Mm-hmm. You know, mandatories don't count boxing no more. Let's just be honest. So, you know, Wilder, Joshua, unification fight. Under that, hey, Briggs. Under that, Parker White. Heavyweight night. Mm. And it's all good matchups. You know, it's all people willing to fight in the UK, willing to be in the UK, willing to make that money in O2 Arena. Y'all didn't know I knew that O2 Arena. Okay. But, you know, let's see something happen. Since everybody is so willing to do business, let's get it happen. Let's get it popping.
Quick note, we didn't talk about this fight, but Javier Fortuna got knocked out in the 10th round or 11th round against Jason Sosa. Jason Sosa, the guy who got that controversial draw with Nicholas Walters. You know what? Sosa just exposed what a lot of people thought about Fortuna. And what we've said a lot, when Fortuna is good, he's good. When he's not, he ain't. he is Jekyll and Hyde. He is either great or stinky. He was stinky in that fight.
There's no way, no nice way to say this, but it's exactly piggybacking on that. If you can get him to stoop down to your level, you can even bait him down to your level. You don't. He doesn't even have to be your level. You could just bait him into a, and that could happen. That doesn't even have to happen in the ring. That can happen as soon as you sign the fight. As soon as you, oh man, this guy looks like he's hunched over. He looks weak. Oh, I'm not really taking him seriously. He's not giving me eye. You could bait him into lulling him to sleep.
Let's just do this. Let's see what I was gonna say. I had something in there for that too. Nicholas Walters, you know, if he's smart, he goes and tries to get that rematch with Sosa.
He's going to get that rematch.
Try to get that title, then you can start talk Lomachenko all over again at 130. JP, you haven't had a chance. Go ahead. Well, you did have a chance to talk about Canelo. People actually didn't hear that. I had to redo it because it didn't. And just any thoughts on Canelo's situation? I said it. I think he's going to wait till May of 2018. That's what I think. That's just my opinion, and that fight with Smith kind of locks it in.
You know, all this happened after my opinion, so I'm going to start with the Coming to America reference. You must be out of your goddamn mind! first of all, he's just digging a worse hole. His team is digging a worse hole. Because, let's be honest, you know, we don't fuck around. You fucking around. People are looking at, who? You fighting what? Wait a minute. Where this guy came from? All of a sudden, we go from Triple G to Smith. And then they got other fighters. You know, everybody keeps, it's good for business. It's good for business. You have to prove this shit to me, because I don't fucking see it. Because you turning everybody off. And I'm just going to blow a hole in the new boxing, we're gonna do this like Mayweather and Pacquiao. Okay, look, you stupid motherfuckers. The 5 years that we waited on the Mayweather Pacquiao fight, here's first thing. They either fought champions or the hottest fighter out, per se. Or, you know, somebody who just won a championship. That's why I had to say per se. Because when we look at Algeria, you're like, what the fuck is that shit? And look at, who the fuck was that? Who the fuck was that? Guerrero was off of Berto, right? Mm-hmm. And who was the other one? He was like, and Berto, that people were like, oh my God. But that, you know, that was after the Pacquiao fight, so we ain't gonna count the Berto. But that was with champions. Those were people who actually beat people on the way up the hill. Who the fuck is this? Compared to who's out there. Now, another thing. Last time I checked, the Manny Pacquiao Floyd Mayweather fight was very, very profitable, but nobody liked it. So it left a bad taste in everybody's mouth. So if you're gonna do this, you better understand one thing. People are expecting it to be a shitty fight if you following that business model. That's the part that I seem, you know, but Canelo is different. No, he's not different. Mm-mm. You can't change people's minds and feelings. Now, on top of that, let us please stop acting like we don't remember history and saying that first Floyd tried to make the fight, then Manny tried to make the fight. So in those 5 years, the third fight was the John, but there were two other fights that got fucked up. So this shit, I'm gonna fight him next year. I don't want to throw salt in your game, but you remember when Canelo was the guy that showed up to everybody's fight and they lost? You gonna fuck around and be on that in the karma. It's either that, or what happens if Jacobs beats Saunders? And then it's like, well, okay, Jacobs versus Triple G. And what you gonna slide your happy ass in after that? After beating Smith, and who's next if you beat Smith? Who the fuck is next?
Johnson, just a random name, Smith.
Yeah. this is high level fuckery right now. At what weight again?
154, buddy.
54. So you build in another excuse to say, oh, see, I'm a 55 fighter, but now I'm down to 54 and I gotta work my way back up to, man, get the fuck out of here.
I guess it's that old saying, you gotta tear something down to build it back up. So they're tearing down the weight, going back to 54 to build it up.
Now here's the question. So if you're tearing your ass down, why the fuck weren't you fighting people at 54? If all of a sudden you're too big. Now that 1 pound is, I gotta go. I'm gonna say this, and I don't mean no disrespect, but I'm gonna be mean as a motherfucker. The minute you let people, whether it's you or your team, put a bullseye to the bitch in you, nobody's gonna respect you. The people that you're fighting, they've lost respect for you. The people that you're gonna fight in the future, they've lost respect for you. And like I said this the last time, but y'all didn't hear, I was like, he's ingenious in the ring. He's a great fucking fighter. But the last thing you want to do is have motherfuckers lose all respect for you because you give them psychological confidence. And now people are not looking at Canelo like the young superstar kid. They're looking at him like, you know what? Canelo has become the Oscar De La Hoya that people hated. Now, Oscar De La Hoya was great, but everybody who watched boxing back in the day, it was a reason why he went through that phase where he was hated by people. Because he did all the little sneaky bullshit to stay ahead. It was all that little Sugar Ray Leonard-esque bullshit to stay ahead. You know? I'm not going to say it didn't work, because he's still a Golden Boy. He got the Golden Boy promotion. The shit obviously worked. But when you put him in a situation that it was no running from, it showed up. And this is one of them situations, you do not want to meet a motherfucker who has a Marcos Maidana mindset. Because everything y'all building, he was going to crush that shit. I don't even want to be getting on your ass. I really do like you, but you know what? That's some bullshit.
All right.
You know? Oh, with all due respect.
No, of course. All due respect. all right. So here we go. Throwback fight. We have a few minutes. Let's hit it. We appreciate the submissions. This time, me and JP took our own submission. I put up fights, including you guys' suggestions. Thank you, Neeson. Thank you, Mo from the Boxed Out Podcast. But there was one I threw in there, and he picked it. And I'm like, you know what? That's the one I was going for. So we go back. November 12th, 1982, Miami, Florida, in the Orange Bowl on HBO with Barry Tompkins, Sugar Ray Leonard, Larry Merchant on the call. Alexis Arguello versus Aaron Pryor. Lightweight title at stake in one of the most infamous fights because of the last round. what a fight, JP. I mean, as soon as they come out from the corner, you knew it. Like, these motherfuckers, it was like ding, ding, boom. They're already hitting each other. It was like, remember when, what was it? When Rocky came out at Clubber Lang, running across. That's how it seemed. But they met each other in the middle. Man, these guys were going back and forth and killing each other, and just, oh my God, what a fight! I mean, it was literally like Arguello wins one, Pryor wins one, and Arguello wins one, and Pryor wins two, and then Arguello comes back. These guys were landing so many big shots, gigantic chins on both of those guys. Amazing.
Hocking up. You know what? This was actually like a prelude, technically, to Thurman and Porter. You know, first of all, I had to watch it minute by minute, because 1 minute was Pryor's minute, the next minute was Arguello's minute, the next minute, and then they flip-flop. Like, they never... First of all, the heart was tremendous, because every time a fighter got rocked, they took a step back, like, nah, mm-hmm. I ain't letting that shit slide. And they bang, 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 you feel me now? And then, nah, I'm not letting that slide. It was, that's the fighting, that's fighting. Mm-hmm. That wasn't boxing, that was fighting. Because 1 minute, it was fighting. The next minute, it was boxing. The next minute, it was brawling. The next minute, it was just, I don't give a fuck. Whatever works, works. You know, and they talk about the pace and everything, but the funny part about the pace in that fight was this. Looking at it now, the pace was all heart. Because even if somebody landed a shot, even if they were sluggish, and I ain't talking about the infamous rounds, I'm talking about even before that. Mm-hmm. A fighter gets sluggish, he's getting ass whipped, he lands one clean shot. You know what? I'm on your ass. Mm-hmm. They re-energized, fuck, 10, 20, 30 times in that fight.
I don't even know what the punch that's where. I didn't even look that up because I didn't give a shit.
And you can watch it on YouTube. For all you people who don't know, just type in one of the names and the shit gonna say both names, one or two.
One is definitely better than two. Now, I was 8 years old. These are one of the first fights that I vividly remember watching. This one, like I told you, Mancini and Dooku Kim, Larry Holmes and Jerry Cooney. I remember seeing those fights. You know what I mean? These are my first, like, memories of big fights. You know what? I give myself credit. This is exactly how I remember the fight. I had it 7-6 prior going into the 14th round. Yes, the 14th round, people. You youngins, yes, I remember those days of the 15-round fights. But like you're saying, they're going back and forth. They're killing each other. One thing that I liked was that they weren't selling me on this fight. I love that they were just calling it, great fight, great fight. Never once they say, this is fight of the year, and they're trying to sell you. No, you knew you were watching greatness. They didn't have to sell it. Another thing is, I remember, then it reminded me how bad Sugar Ray Leonard is at calling fights. He's terrible. He always has been, and he always will be. There's no way these guys are going to be able to go more than 10 rounds. There's absolutely no way. 10th round comes. I didn't think they were going to be able to do this. I guess now they're just going to go 15 like this. You know, Sugar Ray's so bad. At one point, he was very honest because, you know, he was supposed to fight Aaron Pryor. I'm glad I retired when he was watching this fight.
Which retirement was it? You know, I ain't
one of the 10 retirements.
Yeah.
But of course, we know in the 13th round, Arguello is finally getting to Pryor a little bit, where his punches are starting to have effect. And Pryor is slowing down a little bit. The punches are a little bit more wide. Not saying he's getting ready to go out, but you just see the momentum switch. Then, of course, in between rounds, Panama Lewis, the infamous corner man, says, give him some water. No, not that bottle. Give him the bottle I mixed. And somehow Pryor comes out and rejuvenated, throwing clean, sharp, straight punches, and with power that hadn't been on since like the round 4 or 5, in the infamous water and Perrier really ice cold because it opened up your lungs.
I was about to tell you, let me tell y'all something. I don't know. They didn't test for Perrier back in the day. All right? So I'm going to try this week. I'm going to hit the gym. And I'm going to try this Perrier tap water.
Ice cold.
Ice cold. If I come around here looking like CT Fletcher or Cali Muscle, I'm gonna tell you right now, you know what? I'm drinking Pryor for the rest of my life. I doubt it's gonna happen though.
No, I doubt it. I really do doubt it's gonna happen. And it kinda sucks because it adds to the lore of the fight, but takes away from what these two actually did in the ring, because it's one of the greatest fights you'll ever watch.
That, this is why I'm glad they had a rematch. Even though the rematch happened the way it happened, I'm glad they had a rematch, because that sentence alone left that fight up in the air. That sentence alone, in some ways, left Pryor's greatness up in the air. Because when you do stuff like that, it's the same way. That is the same energy that's put forth to knocking Margarito. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So it's like, I'm glad you ran it back, but that does put a, you know, it puts a little bit of like, yeah. The way he fought the whole fight, you mm-hmm. got to give him credit, because it's like, shit, you fighting your ass off. But that one sentence fucks it all up. But it's still a great fight.
One of the greatest you'll ever see. And never once were you just sold on how what you were watching was history. It was a great fight, man. There's no way around it. So, yes, sir.
Sorry about that. And I just got to say, that's when men with porn mustaches were killers. Mm.
They both had good mustaches. So, guys, go ahead. If you haven't, check out that fight. It's one of those fights that you'll say, and the way that it's set up on YouTube, you don't really get too much in between. It's 45 minutes in and out for 14 rounds. You got to like it.
Did you notice time was a whole lot faster in the 80s?
It sure seemed like it, huh?
Yeah. These clocks nowadays, that's 2 hours.
So, again, thanks for the submissions. Trust me, we'll be getting to yours, because there is not shit happening these next couple weeks. But everybody, follow the show on Twitter, Cheap Seats Box, iTunes, and Stitcher, rate and review. You got to give us a rate and review for the damn Arguello Pryor 1. Come on, man.
I'm going to give you some barbecue tips for the 4th of July. You know, if you, because most of you motherfuckers drinking, so you can't cook. So you get a rate and review, I'll help you out. Because you're going to have a shitty week if you just drinking all weekend and turn it on the grill.
And you can email us, of course, cheapseatsboxing@yahoo.com. All the other stuff. Just rate and review. Help us out. Continue to appreciate you for all the listening. JP, anything else, man?
Man, this is where the fighters fighting the fans commentate.
And we do it just like you from the cheap seats, because we ain't buying no tickets. Goddamn it. Peace.